we've diagnosed a plethora of issues in our Fix or Flop playlist. If you haven't heard of that playlist, you are missing out. It'll be linked below if you want to check it out. But one of the more common themes that I've seen from folks who are inquiring about having their system fixed for free is overheating. My CPU temps are running way too high, and I don't know how to fix them. I've checked all my fans are turning, and no matter what I do, my CPU temps reach crazy high temperatures, and then the system shuts off or blue screens. Neither of those things is particularly fun. The blue screen of death one I'd be a bit more afraid of, just personally, because I hate troubleshooting software, and a lot of times software causes blue screens of death, or software conflicts, I should say. But when it comes to systems straight up overheating, a lot of times, if you have an AIO, it's because the pump died. And in this video, I'm going to show you what happens when the pump dies, so that if this happens to you in the future, you'll know how to properly diagnose it. Stay with me.
To get rid of that annoying Windows activation watermark, hop on over to VIP SCD Key, where you can purchase a Windows 10 OEM key for a fraction of the price of retail. Just use a secure payment method like PayPal, enter the product key in your PC settings, and say bye-bye to the watermark. And be sure to use our offer code SKGS for a special 1111 discount of 30%.
So let's jump right into symptoms that you might see, and then I'll show you firsthand what happens when you disconnect a pump. I'll use this system for demonstration purposes. So when your system gets too hot, and this could be a result of a number of things, not just if your pump dies, maybe you don't have good airflow, maybe your case is just a hot box, it doesn't really matter. The point is, if your CPU approaches T-junction, typically that's between 95 and 105 degrees Celsius, the computer will shut itself off in an effort to preserve itself. It's like a last-ditch, kind of last-resort effort to save vital components, including the CPU and the motherboard, which could potentially die with it, and even the power supply. We really should be happy that these safety nets are in place. A lot of older PCs didn't have these fail-safes, and as a result, their platforms would literally cook themselves to death. You could fry eggs on CPUs, easy, no problem. Just like weld a little pan to the top of the IHS and there you go, you can cook breakfast. But nowadays, a lot of these systems won't let you do that, at least with temperatures that are desirable for cooking eggs. In fact, there are even ways to disable T-junction, which I won't go into in this video because you don't need to know how to do that. There's absolutely no reason why your CPU should ever reach above that temperature. It will only do harm, not good. So, with that, I'm going to simply disconnect the pump, leave the T-junction parameters in place, and watch what happens. And you guys are going to follow along for the ride so that if this ever happens to you again, you'll be able to kind of just, yeah, oh, that's exactly what my system's doing. You know what? I think I have a dead pump. There you go. I saved you hours of troubleshooting. I've been there, done that. I don't want anyone else to go through that. So to kick things off, let's start with a control. This system houses a Ryzen 5 2600, a B450 or a B550 motherboard. I'm not really sure. It doesn't really matter though. Everything's running at stock. I do have DOCP enabled, so we're running at a higher clocked memory than base at 2133 megahertz. And obviously the AIO in here is a 120 mil. This is from Deepcool. Now I'm not tweaking fan curves. I'm not changing, again, V-Core or anything like that. I'm just leaving this stock. A lot of folks build their systems, don't hop into the BIOS and change a bunch of things, even though there are some benefits doing that. Obviously, enabling DOCP or XMP, maybe tweaking V-Core if your motherboard's just dumping a ton of voltage it doesn't need to into your chip. So there are some things in there that you probably do want to mess with, but more often than not, folks who are maybe first or second time builders just don't know really what they're doing, so they tend to stay away from the BIOS or UEFI. So that's what I've attempted to replicate here, just a system that I built kind of from scratch, and it, you know, it just works. It powers on, we loaded up Windows, and there you go. So what I did was download IDA64 Engineer. If you're not aware of what IDA64 is, it's a great software for just pretty much anything, diagnostics, troubleshooting, can do temperature tests, burn-ins, things like that. It's not as heavy as Prime95, in fact, nowhere close to it, but if you want to do some kind of long-term CPU stability testing, you can do that in IDA64, and that's what you're seeing here with this chart. So the temperature with the pump running appropriately with just a default fan curve, you can see never really touched 70 degrees Celsius, stayed in the mid 60s, which makes sense for a 2600, very low TDP. It's a very efficient chip in that regard, and a 120 mAh is just, it's fine for it, right? Nothing out of the ordinary here. Now, it's important that we let this test run for 30 minutes at least. I'd say for larger AIOs, probably an hour. You can see this one's pretty much flatlined after about 10 minutes or so, but I always like to let it stretch out to 30 at the minimum when it comes to liquid cooling, because water has a higher heat capacity than most metals used in air tower coolers. And as a result of that, you usually need to wait a bit longer for that water to equalize to the heat output being dumped by the CPU. So yeah, and again, mid-60s, looking pretty good here. And we're gonna do the exact same thing, or attempt to run this test for the exact same amount of time without the pump running. And I can already tell you, again, from experience, that this is not gonna end well. So as you can see in the graph, we've allowed temperatures to return to idle around 30 degrees Celsius. That means that the fluid in this loop has, again, kind of equalized to atmosphere temperature. What I'm going to do is simply disconnect the pump cable, which is powered, it's actually powered through the cable itself. Sometimes you'll find like SATA or Molex power for these pumps. That's just separate power. Sometimes you need to connect a proprietary connector. A lot of Corsair AIOs are like that. So it really depends on the unit, but in this case, the pump is being powered directly through the pump cable. So yeah, what we're gonna see here are temperatures steadily climbing. We are at idle here. Apart from IDA64 being open and a few other background tasks, this system is under no sustained heavy load at all, and temperatures will probably still slightly increase over time. And the reason why is because all the heat being kept here is not being circulated to the radiator. So picture this like its own kind of standalone tower, maybe an aluminum tower, and there's no fan attached to it, right? So all that heat is just building up here, and it's not being transported where it needs to be transported for active cooling with this fan. That's not good. What I'm gonna do is put the side panel back on to simulate real world use, and we'll see what happens. Now, by looking at this graph, can you tell where I disconnected the pump? It should be pretty obvious. This is with the pump on. This was about a 20 minute or so gap here. And then you can see how temperatures immediately started climbing, and they will continue to do so until I imagine the CPU overheats and the system shuts down. This is a very common dead pump symptom. Now, while this test is running, there is another easy way to tell if a pump is dead. Obviously, you can check temperatures. If they continue to climb, especially at idle, that's a bad sign. It means that you probably didn't seat the AIO properly. Maybe the block isn't making proper contact with the IHS, or maybe you forgot to use thermal paste or forgot to remove the plastic covering on the bottom side of the block over the cold plate, or maybe the pump is dead, right? But an easy way to tell that the pump is dead is by grabbing the tubes, okay? If you have an AIO that's working just fine right now, grab the tubes and try to remember what that feels like. You got that fluid churning through them, and that little vibration there that you're picking up is a good sign. If you grab these tubes at some point and you don't feel those vibrations, when of course your system is on because the pump has to be turning for this to work, then that means that your pump is dead. So memorize that feeling now. If you have an AIO, just store it somewhere in your head. And then if you ever notice that CPU temps just continue to climb and never really stop until your system shuts down, just grab the tubes. It's an easy way to troubleshoot whether or not your pump is dead. Now back to our test bed, you can see temperatures have continued to climb. You would think that just by looking at this chart, we were under some kind of heavy load, but we haven't even started the stability test in IDA64 yet. This system is essentially at idle. But you'd think we were under load based on how crazy these temperatures have behaved. And another thing, don't be fooled by the fans in your system. At this point, the fan attached to the radiator here is just churning. The RPM is very high, much higher than what it was at idle, even though we're still at idle. But the air back here, I'm putting my hand behind the radiator. This air is at room temperature. That should not be the case. If the pump was properly moving the heat from the source to the radiator, where it is essentially convected to atmosphere, we'd be feeling heat back here. But this is literally just, it's room temperature. That's not good. Another way to tell that your pump is bad. So we could simply let these temperatures continue to climb while the system is at idle, and it might take several minutes, especially with the 2600, because again, the TDP is fairly low. We're not dumping a ton of heat at idle. But what we're gonna go ahead and do is stop this test, allow fluid temps to return to room temperature or thereabouts, and then turn on the stability test. We're gonna click the start button on the bottom left of the screen and allow the temps to just skyrocket. It's not gonna be pretty. So here we go, we just disconnected the pump again after temperatures had flatlined, and we're gonna start the stability test. This is not gonna be good. Okay, here we go. Oh boy. I'm not liking this, really hoping I don't permanently damage the CPU. Okay, it's continuing to rise. Fans are pretty much max speed. We're at 90 degrees Celsius, 101 degrees Celsius. So the system is actually, it's still going. It's kind of funny, but I think it is throttling itself fairly hard. What are we at here? CPU frequency is what I want. And yeah, current frequency. 500 megahertz. That's what we're at right now, folks. 500 megahertz. For comparison, the standard clock speed of this chip is somewhere around 3 to 3.5-ish gigahertz. So we're right around half of 1 gigahertz. That's pretty awful. Okay, yeah, we are sustained at over 100 degrees Celsius now. System still hasn't shut off yet. I'm kind of surprised. I know Intel at this point would have definitely shut off, but AMD is just throttling back frequency. It's trying to keep the system on, at least somewhat functional. But again, 500 megahertz is just, that's an abysmal clock speed. And that there is T-junction. This is, yep, 106. Okay, all right, I'm calling it. I don't know why it's not shutting off. It should be shutting off right now, but these temperatures are just, yeah, these temperatures are bad. Okay. All right, I think we made our point. And would you look at that, just as quickly as the CPU heated up, the temperature also dipped at about the same rate once we reconnected the pump and shut off the stress test. So that's a very, very quick recovery, but at the same time, you never want to see your temperatures reach triple digits in Celsius, at least. If you're measuring in Fahrenheit, you know, I'm sure triple digits is going to be just fine, but 100 degrees Celsius is no bueno for most, if not all, modern consumer desktop chips. Another cool thing to show you, I took my floor imaging camera to the AIO, both with the pump disconnected, simulating a dead pump scenario, and with the pump connected and functioning properly. You can see that on the left, with the pump not working, that a lot of heat is built up in just one tube, and especially under the CPU block. And it's kind of hard to see under the block itself. This is just mapping surface temperature here, so the plastic basically comprising the CPU block is not very hot, but under that I can assure you it is extremely toasty, and one of the tubes is also very hot. This I imagine leads directly into the fin stack, where the fluid would kind of pick up the heat and then pull it to the radiator. It's not good to see something like this where you've got heat just soaking one side of a closed system. If the pump was functioning properly, you'd see what we see on the right picture here, where you really have an even distribution of heat over time. Now, you could see small, maybe one tube is a bit hotter than the other, especially in longer systems where you're getting tons of heat dumped into the system. You can see this in car radiators especially. But in a very small build like this, even under idle conditions, which this photo was taken at idle, you shouldn't be seeing all that heat pent up on one side. Well, that was a bit unexpected. I guess I'm a bit more experienced with overheating when it comes to more modern Intel chips. Ryzen tends to not be that hot. But anyway, I hope that this at least gets the point across. When it comes to overheating CPUs and potentially in, like, motherboards overheating and other things that are next to the CPU, could be a dead pump. And there are easy ways to check. Just grab the tubes. You can feel the pump churning fluid in there. That's a good sign. Otherwise, if your system is randomly shutting off in the middle of especially heavy gaming and other scenarios like that, or even at idle after, I've heard it happen after a few seconds, because sometimes when the system starts up, the CPU is under a bit of a load, even that could cause the system to immediately shut back off. Again, in an effort to save itself, check the pump. Check the fluid churning in the pump itself. If you can get into your desktop, check temperatures. If they keep rising, yeah, you've probably got a dead pump if you're rocking an AIO. With that, if you enjoyed this fun little video, be sure to let me know by giving this one a thumbs up. I appreciate that. You know, sometimes it's better to just like kill two birds with one stone by making a video like this. When I come across scenarios in the email chains or the email threads that I get from folks inquiring about participating in the Fix or Flop playlist, a lot of them that have overheating issues, usually I just tell them to check the pump, and that ends up being the issue. So instead of just seeing so many of those over and over, this one video I hope should suffice. And what I'll end up doing, if I suspect that's to blame, is link those folks this video here, and maybe it'll point them in the right direction. With that, consider leaving a like if you haven't already, consider subscribing if you haven't already, and I'll catch you in the next one. My name is Greg. Thanks for learning with me.